You know that when you're sleep deprived, you have a higher likelihood of gaining fat, okay? Let's not kid ourselves. You see it all the time. We see it in papers and we see it in real life. The moment that someone starts losing sleep, they start packing on the pounds and their life just kind of just gets out of control, right? There are some ways that we can change this a bit. We can't always change the fact that we're not gonna get a lot of sleep. I've got a newborn in the house. I know I'm not gonna get a lot of sleep. So I have that proper just mindfulness of that situation, and it allows me to make proper decisions. That's exactly why I wanted to create this video, because I know you are probably going through a similar thing. You know you're gonna have a period of time where you're sleep deprived. So what's some damage control? What's a stopgap that you can put in place to still stay healthy and stay lean? Hey, before I get into the science, I wanna ask that you please, please, please hit that red subscribe button. You won't be disappointed. We've got videos coming out just about every single day that are gonna help you in so many aspects of your nutritional life. Okay, also hit that little bell icon. That way you can turn on notifications and select all notifications so you never ever miss our daily videos. All right. First, before we get into what you can do tangibly, let's talk about what's happening inside your body. Education leads to adherence. If you know what's going on, you can fix it. Okay, sleep deprivation essentially is seen as a perceived threat within the body. Okay, we're not designed to be super sleep deprived all the time. So when we are, we have an increase in the sympathetic nervous system, which is essentially our fight or flight, right? So our body sees us as having a threat. Well, this is not supposed to go on for a lifetime. It's supposed to go on for short periods of time, but in our stressful lives, of course, we do experience it for a long period of time. Anyway, here's what happens from a hormonal side of things. The Journal of Endocrinology and Metabolism published a study that demonstrated that when we are sleep deprived, we have decreasing levels of circulating leptin. Okay, leptin is a satiety hormone, but it's also involved in a lot of different thermoregulatory processes, increasing body heat and things like that. But that's not the big issue here. Well, it kind of is, but it's indirectly the issue. You see, when leptin levels are decreasing, we have increased levels of ghrelin, which is the opposite of leptin. Ghrelin makes us feel hungry. It's the hunger hormone. So as leptin is the satiety hormone, ghrelin is the hunger hormone. Now, you may have heard of leptin before as sort of the cheat meal hormone. Okay, when we are on a diet or anything like that and you have a cheat meal, it spikes your metabolism, or I say that with air quotes because it doesn't really. It spikes your metabolism because you have an increase in leptin, which can increase thermogenesis, increase body heat, and sort of increase satiety emotionally. So if our leptin levels are lower, we have less of that hormone that's making us feel satiated. But let's talk about thermogenesis for just a second. Okay, if we have a decrease in leptin, then we potentially have a decrease in energy expenditure. You see, again, leptin tells us that we have plenty of fuel on hand. And if we have plenty of fuel, i.e. fat on hand, the body can rev up just these sort of thermogenic properties where we dissipate extra energy as heat. Okay, so think of it like this. We have excess calories coming in. Some of those calories are gonna be used as fuel. If we have excess, some of that percentage is gonna be allocated towards just dissipating as heat. That's thermogenesis. Well, if leptin levels are low, then we have dysregulation of that thermogenesis. We have less body heat being created, which means less calories being burned. So kind of a double whammy, right? We have less satiety and more hunger hormones, so we eat more, and then our energy balance is messed up because we're not expending as much energy through non-exercise thermogenesis, right? So this is where fasting can come in as a solution, but I wanna make sure that I say this early in the video so you don't think this is just like some one-sided discussion. Okay, fasting can work to help you out when it comes down to managing your weight when you're sleep deprived, but only in specific situations, okay? Fasting should be used in a short-term kind of deal, right? Maybe you know you have some crazy exams coming up. Maybe you know you're going through a short-term audit. Maybe you know you're going through something stressful at work and you know you're not gonna sleep well because you're stressed out. Now, you should never really plant that seed in your head because yes, if you do that, then you're not gonna sleep anyway, but that's a different discussion, okay? Point is that when you know it's gonna be short-lived, you can implement fasting. Why? Because fasting is going to have an effect where, well, quite frankly, you're not gonna make the poor decisions. In the short term, when you're sleep deprived, one could even argue that fasting is gonna increase the catecholamines that allow you to burn more fat. You see, it kind of looks like this. If you're sleep deprived, you have an increase in epinephrine, increase in adrenaline, which are all actually fat mobilizing. You just have a subsequent decrease in leptin, which is kind of messing things up. But if you're not bringing in the food, then you have no choice but to actually burn fat. So it could work short term. Operative words, short term. You see, here's the thing. When it comes down to satiety and satiation, Our body generally produces about 3 pulses of ghrelin, the hunger hormone, throughout the course of the day. Well, studies indicate that even when you're fasting, your body still produces those 3 pulses of ghrelin. So you're still having pulses of the hunger hormone that are sort of scheduled at their diurnal rhythms. But what does happen when you're fasting is you dramatically reduce the number of sort of impromptu pulses of ghrelin. So the random surges of hunger that would come along simply because you're low in leptin probably won't come to be. So therefore, you could consume less outside of just the fact that you're not eating because you're fasting. When it is time to eat, you'll probably consume less too, which is great. But the reason that it's not the answer for long-term stuff is when you're fasting, you're also having an increase in stress hormones, which can cause this sort of chain reaction where you don't sleep as good and then it causes the big problem again, et cetera, et cetera. So what you want to do is if you know that you're going to be embarking on a stressful period of your life, if you know, once again, that you've got exams coming up or a stressful period, you want to condition yourself to fasting before the stress hits. Why? Because exposing yourself to a little bit of stress from the fasting can increase what is called leptin sensitivity. It means that your body's cells and your leptin receptors will be able to do more with less leptin. So when you do encounter your sleepless nights, your cells know how to operate on less leptin. So condition yourself to fasting while you are sleeping good. Then for the short-term periods when you are stressed out, heck yeah, rev up the fasting. In fact, do some longer fasts because you get an additional benefit. Okay, remember this, when you're fasting, sure, you decrease leptin to some degree, but not that much. But what ends up happening is if you fast long enough and you do it strict enough, you have an elevation of ketone bodies, which can combat ghrelin. So you still have your increase in ghrelin, but you have your increase in ketones that actually kind of mitigate that a little bit. That's long and complicated, but the point is, fasting in the short term can work. And I would recommend just doing like 16, 20-hour fasts every other day during your sleepless periods of time. I know fasting can be super, super complicated, but if you're interested, I did put a link down below for Thrive Market because I've been able to create what are called fasting boxes with Thrive. So Thrive is an online membership-based grocery store, so you can get all kinds of foods that you would normally get at the grocery store, but get them shipped right to your doorstep. It's really, really cool, but my partnership with Thrive has made it so I've been able to create literally fasting boxes. So they're basically boxes of groceries that I would recommend you get if you're practicing intermittent fasting or if you're doing a ketogenic diet, all kinds of different personalized bundles that I've created, but you don't have to do that. You can get whatever groceries you want. Anyhow, they're a big supporter of this channel, big sponsor of this channel, and there's special access down below if you want to use that link after you finish watching this video. I highly, highly recommend that you check them out, and a big thank you to Thrive Market for supporting this channel and keeping us rocking and rolling. Before I move on to the other things that you can do to control fat gain when you're sleep deprived, let's talk about the mental piece for just a second. The American Journal of Clinical Nutrition demonstrated that when you are sleep deprived, your reward-seeking behavior changes. You end up getting more stimulated from a reward standpoint from food than you ordinarily would. It just heightens your response to that, which ends up causing a feedback loop that makes you just want to really get addicted to food. It can be a big problem. So with fasting, you're making one large, strict decision at the beginning of the day compared to making continual kind of endurance-based decisions the rest of the day. For example, it's easier for me to wake up in the morning, make a clear, concise, defined decision that I'm not going to eat today than it is to abstain and try to control portions and try to control what I eat throughout the rest of the day. So when I'm sleep deprived and I just don't have the mental capacity to think about that stuff, it's easy for me to just draw a line in the sand and say I'm not gonna eat. So from a mental perspective, fasting probably does work a whole lot. But there's some situations where it really wouldn't. So now let's look at the other side of the equation. Protein consumption. Okay, now I'm gonna talk about this because I just had a newborn. Okay, I've got a newborn in the house along with a toddler. There's no denying that my sleep is going to be jeopardized. So what am I going to do? And that's exactly why I'm doing this video. Well, one thing for sure is I'm gonna increase my protein intake. Okay, this isn't just saying protein is satiating because it doesn't digest as fast. Well, that's true, but what's really interesting is that there was even a study that was published in the International Journal of Obesity that showed protein, and in particular the amino acid cysteine, can inhibit ghrelin. It lowers ghrelin levels. So yes, protein is satiating as a whole from a volume and mechanical digestive standpoint, but even from sort of a biochemical response, the cysteine, which is an amino acid, reduces ghrelin levels. So I'm gonna increase my protein intake as much as I possibly can while still being healthy, but I also might take some cysteine supplements to help promote the at least reduction of ghrelin and hopefully get that leptin stimulation back up. I also know that while I'm sleep deprived for a long period of time, my glucose metabolism is going to be messed up. There are studies again that show that sleep deprivation dysregulates your glucose metabolism, which just basically means that your cells aren't as good at using blood sugar. They're not as good at using it. They're inefficient, which means your blood sugar could be elevated and you could go through these dips. So what can I do there? Okay, well, I can do things like add cinnamon to my coffee. I can do things like have apple cider vinegar, things that are going to manage my blood sugar and help my cells utilize glucose better. That may sound like this embryonic basic health science, but it's actually a big, big trick when it comes down to not wanting to munch on food unconsciously when you're sleep deprived. Now let's move into something that's a little bit more unique though. Okay, grains, gluten, and lectins. And I'm not just some health nerd that's talking about the elimination of gluten because it's trendy, okay? What has been demonstrated is that gluten binds, there's protein, the protein that's in gluten binds to leptin receptors. Okay, when it binds to leptin receptors, it makes it so that the leptin cannot bind to the receptor as well. So you already have low levels of leptin. Okay, those low levels of leptin are already causing you problems, but then what little leptin you do have that normally would be able to bind to a receptor cannot bind to the receptor as well because you have, what do you know? You have gluten hanging out on the receptor blocking it. It's like someone sitting on the squat rack doing curls so you can't get in there to do squats, right? That's exactly what's happening. It's blocking that sucker. So therefore, get the gluten out of the diet. But the lectins that you're gonna find in grains and quinoa, things like that, those can cause problems too. So yes, I'm reducing grains. Any carbs that I would have, I'm switching out to potatoes and things like that. Grains have benefits in some ways, but not when you're sleep deprived, okay? And then additionally, I know I'm getting hopped up on this, but fructose. This is a really big one. Okay, fructose is going to decrease levels of circulating leptin as well. So again, we already have low levels of leptin from sleep deprivation. Then we have the leptin not being able to bind to the receptor. And now we add fructose into the mix, which crushes those leptin levels even more. So that means the foods like fruit and stuff like that probably need to be minimized unless they're very low glycemic, like maybe some strawberries, some raspberries, and some blueberries. There's another big elephant in the room that we have to touch on too, and that's cortisol. Okay, we've talked about adrenaline a little bit. We've talked about leptin. I used to see the commercials all the time that used to talk about how cortisol contributes to belly fat and blah, 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 blah. Cortisol can be good and cortisol can be bad. If cortisol is elevated at the right time when it should be, it's going to allow glucose to enter the bloodstream or be consolidated into the bloodstream so that we can have energy. It can also allow fat to be mobilized. It can really work in our favor, but we're not designed to have chronically high levels of cortisol. Okay, our bodies haven't caught up with where we are in our daily lives, right? From an evolutionary standpoint, we were designed to have spikes of cortisol that would come into play when we would be chased by a tiger. We're not being chased by a tiger for a month straight, okay? So our bodies aren't accustomed to that. So what happens is we have this huge, once again, dysregulation of glucose. And what happens when the cortisol levels are high because you're sleep deprived is your liver starts going through what's called hepatic gluconeogenesis. That hepatic gluconeogenesis is where your liver creates sugar from other substrates, in further increasing that glycemic amount in your blood, right? You have more sugar in your blood. This causes a myriad of different issues, but I want you to think about something. Again, playing devil's advocate. You're stressed out, your cortisol levels are high, and you start to fast. Well, guess what? Fasting is going to increase cortisol more. So now you just doubled down on the amount of glucose in your bloodstream, potentially increasing your cravings. So fasting ends up becoming just this game of cat and mouse of mental fortitude versus every physiological power within your body telling you to eat. Cortisol, blood sugar, leptin, ghrelin, all compelling you to eat, and it just comes down to a matter of willpower. At what point do you draw a line and say, I can't do this anymore because it's taking away from energy that you would put in other things? My reason in saying this is to be very honest. I love fasting as much as the next guy, but once again, fasting will work if you have a finite amount of time where you'll be sleep deprived. If you try to implement fasting as a tool to constantly combat sleep deprivation for months on end, you will dig yourself into a hole. So implement cysteine, implement high amounts of protein, eliminate the glutens, eliminate the grains, and definitely, definitely watch the fructose, especially the high fructose corn syrup and things like that. Okay, that's the big takeaway. Short term, 16, 20 hour fasting, and definitely gonna help you out there. As always, make sure you're locked in, and I'll see you tomorrow.